If an important customer or investor asked you, what is your organisation's carbon footprint, would you know? Measuring a carbon footprint is perhaps the most important skill in carbon management. After all, you can't manage what you haven't measured. You're about to fast-track your skills in carbon footprinting. Coming up next in Carbon 101X is a hands-on exercise where you'll calculate the carbon footprint of a Tasland organisation. But first, an introduction. What is carbon footprinting? A carbon footprint, or greenhouse gas emissions inventory, is a way of quantifying the amount of carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gases released into the atmosphere as a result of a particular individual, organisation, community, event, product or service. Clearly, there are many types of carbon footprints you can undertake, but let's focus on organisational carbon footprints. So why are carbon footprints important to an organisation? From a compliance point of view, command and control and carbon pricing policies often have emissions thresholds that dictate which organisations need to comply and which don't. So you need to know your organisation's carbon footprint before you can know whether or not it's covered by a particular climate policy. But carbon footprinting is not just about compliance. Many organisations now voluntarily report their sustainability performance, including carbon footprints, to staff, customers, shareholders, and to investment knowledge-related schemes, such as the Carbon Disclosure Project. In fact, in many industries, such as finance and the resource sector, voluntary carbon footprinting is now largely expected. In both cases, organisations need to know how to undertake a carbon footprint according to best practice standards. For example, the Greenhouse Gas Protocol Corporate Accounting Standard and ISO 14064. This takes skill and knowledge to gather the appropriate data, apply emissions factors, categorise emissions by scopes, and report in a clear and consistent way. There are generally five steps in undertaking an organisational carbon footprint. The first step is to determine the reporting timeframe. Usually this is a calendar year, that is, an organisation's emissions between the 1st of January and 31st of December. Alternatively, the reporting timeframe could be the organisation's financial year. The choice should be made on what is most useful and consistent with the organisation's reporting needs. Step two is drawing the organisational boundary. This involves determining which facilities and assets within an organisation you should develop the carbon footprint for. For example, an organisation may have a power plant, a separate administration building, and a vehicle fleet. You might need to include just one, or it might be many. Generally, you calculate the emissions from each of these facilities individually and then add them together to get a carbon footprint figure for the whole organisation. Sounds simple, right? Well, it can get a bit more complicated. Suppose that power plant is owned by your organisation but operated by another. You don't want both organisations to carbon footprint the power plant, as this would mean emissions are double counted. So then, who has the responsibility of ensuring the emissions from the power plant are accounted for? This will be the organisation with the overall operational control. That is, the organisation that has the ability to make changes to processes and equipment that results in an increase or decrease in emissions. Step three involves determining which emission sources should be included in an organisation's carbon footprint. Carbon footprinting uses a system of emission scopes to determine this, where emission sources are classified as either Scope 1, Scope 2, or Scope 3. Scope 1 includes all emissions that occur within the organisational boundary as a direct result of a particular activity. For example, a power plant may directly produce Scope 1 emissions from its flue stack through the burning of coal. Scope 2 includes indirect emissions from purchased electricity, heat, and steam. The difference here is that Scope 2 emissions happen outside the facility's boundary as a consequence of that facility's activities. For example, an administration building may indirectly cause Scope 2 emissions due to the consumption of grid electricity. Here, the administration building's Scope 2 emissions from electricity use would be the power plant's Scope 1 emissions. We categorise emissions into scopes to avoid double counting. Scope 3 emissions are also indirect and include all other emissions from upstream or downstream the organisation's value chain. For example, the administration building would classify emissions from corporate air travel as Scope 3. Carbon footprinting for compliance purposes, for example, under a carbon pricing policy, generally requires only Scope 1 and in some cases Scope 2 emissions to be reported. However, for voluntary reporting and beyond compliance carbon management, organisations should additionally include Scope 3 sources. Now, step 4. Once an organisation knows which facilities and emission sources it will include in its carbon footprint, it can then calculate the emissions from each. There are two ways an organisation can do this. The first is through direct measurement. For example, a big organisation may use measuring equipment to determine the exact amount of carbon dioxide and methane coming from the flue stack of a power plant. For a smaller organisation, though, the more appropriate method would be to use emission factors. This carbon footprinting method is by far the most commonly used. Under this method, an organisation would collect input data, such as litres of fuel or kilowatt hours of electricity used, which is often readily available through invoices and accounting systems. It would then convert this data into tonnes of CO2 equivalent by applying the appropriate government-endorsed emission factors. For example, the World Resource Institute's set of emissions factors estimate that for every 1 kilowatt hour of electricity used in Beijing, 1.128 kilograms of CO2 equivalent is produced. This means a company based in Beijing that uses 10,000 kilowatt hours of electricity from the local grid has a Scope 2 carbon footprint of 11,280 kilograms or 11.28 tonnes of CO2 equivalent. The World Resource Institute and other bodies, such as the United Kingdom's Department of Environment, Food and Rural Affairs, provides a range of emission factors for converting solid, liquid and gaseous fuel data into emissions estimates. The last essential step of the process involves aggregating all of the emissions estimates for each source from each facility to give a carbon footprint for the entire organisation in tonnes of carbon dioxide equivalent. In summary, undertaking a carbon footprint is relatively straightforward. First, an organisation decides the reporting timeframe. Next, it determines the organisational boundary and which emission sources to include. It then collects data and converts this into an emissions estimate for each scope, either using direct measurement or emissions factors. And finally, the organisation aggregates these estimates to form the carbon footprint. As an added step, some organisations may have the carbon footprint audited by an independent third party to add a level of assurance to the estimate, and thus more confidence when it reports it publicly to the government or for compliance purposes. Coming up next is an interactive practical where you will calculate the carbon footprint of a Taslandian organisation. So, when a stakeholder asks you, what is your organisation's carbon footprint, you'll have the skills and knowledge to answer this question.